It's time to talk about everything in the world of Batman this week. Actually, we can't cover everything because there's too many Batman comics, but we're going to cover the three big ones. We're going to hit Batman 123, the fifth part of Shadow War. We're also going to hit Flashpoint Beyond number one, as well as Batman Killing Time number three. And here with me to talk about that is the Batman historian, the DC Comics aficionado himself, Josh McDonald. How you doing, Josh?
I'm doing well, Wes. How are you, man?
I'm doing fantastic. Let's start out with the big crossover story that's going on between Batman, Deathstroke Inc., as well as Robin. Batman 123, Josh Williamson, Howard Porter on art. I don't think this is a bad crossover story, but I'm pretty tired. You can tell that Josh Williamson had a pretty tight story laid out with this, but then when he got the Batman writing gig and it was going to include Batman itself, they probably added the Alpha and Omega and the Warzone stories onto it. And we're kind of just reading the same thing over and over.
Pretty much been treading water here for a little bit. And I'm not shocked that DC decided they wanted to expand this as much as they could to try to get more bang for their buck. It's kind of their way of doing things.
And the thing I think that's really suffered by bloating this out while Josh Williamson is obviously doing this Dark Crisis or getting ready for that, which is even bigger, is I think the dialogue is kind of stale throughout.
Yeah, there's definitely moments of dialogue where it's stale and it kind of looks like they were shooting for some filler. And then it's strange because you'll have moments where the dialogue hits really well and you can tell like, okay, this was planned.
It's been an interesting read. I do say this is probably the second best issue maybe since the very first one that they did. Howard Porter's art, I think he's great on Flash. I don't know that he's the world's best Batman artist, but when they go to Central City, it definitely looks better.
Yeah, you could tell that he was familiar with Central City and more comfortable Central City. I agree. There are times that I've really enjoyed Howard Porter. This is not one of those moments. It almost felt like he was rushed in doing this, and it shows on the page. It wasn't as good as what he typically delivers.
But we have learned the identity of Respawn. He's kind of a clone of Damian, but his dad is Slade Wilson instead of Bruce Wayne. Slade Wilson has taken Respawn under his wing, and they're on the run. And Batman is doing some detective work to figure out who is actually trying to kill or did kill Ra's al Ghul and wounded Talia al Ghul. They end up finding Slade Wilson in San Francisco in an underground lair where he had created so he could kind of be ready for the Teen Titans back in the day. There's some pretty good action here. Like I said, it's just kind of the same thing over and over. Big battle, a little bit of information. Move on.
I don't think the reveal of Respawn was as effective in the previous stories they were hoping it would be. And I didn't really care for Damian's response in that moment, but I liked to see Damian's take on it here. And I guess I should explain the reason I didn't like it for the previous issue was because I'm like, dude, you have a ton of brothers already. They may not be blood brothers, but they're your brothers. Now he's kind of like looking at it as, oh, this is my first chance to be a brother and set an example and then show gratitude to the family that I do have. So I loved that element and I'm happy that was there. But the rest of it was just kind of, And you're right. Decent action, although there is one action scene that I despised, and it was when all the ninjas had the guns and were shooting at Slade, Rose, and Respawn. I just hate when there's like 40 people shooting guns and then no one's getting hit.
No one gets hit, yeah.
Dude, it's like stupid. Other than that, though, no, it's good action. It ends on a note that kind of leaves a decent cliffhanger. I won't say it's shocking, but it lands in an emotional way for Slade, and that's pretty rare. You don't typically see that.
For me as a reader, it didn't really land emotionally because I don't think they've had Respawn out long enough and they never fleshed a character out. So it never really had an attachment with the character, whether it was for good reasons or bad. He was just kind of a plot device that was there and then they end up killing him.
I didn't feel emotional as in sad and I didn't feel it for Respawn. It was more of a like, this is finally connecting with Slade. Hopefully, maybe. That you know, he's got another kid that's dying. We always joke about Robin's dying, but we should joke about Slade losing his kids. In general, time is running out, and they haven't done a lot with this story, and I feel like they still have a lot left to do.
Well, there's only two issues, and I think Warzone left. Let's go move over to the other story that's been intriguing, Flashpoint Beyond number one. Obviously, we had the Zero issue that we both liked. Geoff Johns, Jeremy Adams, and Tim Sheridan helping out with the writing this time. Zermonico on art. I will say this up front, the art looks noticeably better under Zermonico.
Yep.
And that was definitely appreciated because the art in issue zero was so bad. Here's my problem with Flashpoint Beyond. I don't think it's a bad comic book again, but I'm just not all that interested on how the Flashpoint world would have kept going if the event didn't end when it did. So we've got Wonder Woman, you know, basically facing off with Aquaman, and we got this battle of Atlantis versus the Amazons in England and stuff like this. And I just, what is the point of all of this? It felt like in the Zero issue it was going to be kind of tying in to some of the stuff that's happening now, and then this just feels like a continuation on a universe that died 20 years ago.
I think they spend like a grand total of about 2 pages in our current Earth, and then the rest of the story is all dealing with the Flashpoint timeline. As we said the last time we talked about this when the Zero issue came out, I don't really care to learn more about the Flashpoint universe, but I do feel like we keep hinting more and more and more that this is tied to what Doomsday Clock was and potentially what Geoff Johns had originally planned for Doomsday Clock and how it was going to completely unfold. So that has me intrigued. What I will say is, like, the writing is still pretty sharp. They're cramming a lot into this story. It's fast-paced. It actually goes somewhere. It's not super decompressed, which a lot of writers are doing lately. So I'm enjoying it, and I'm looking forward to seeing where it goes, even if I'm not too caught up with the Flashpoint universe.
I will give this. It does have a little bit of a laugh here and there, specifically when Oswald Cobblepot, who works for Thomas Wade, decides that he's going to teach Two-Face's kid, obviously Two-Face is dead, he teaches him how to shoot a gun.
Yeah, you know, I've seen a lot of people get upset with this, and I'm in Texas, I'm like, dude, I think I shot my first gun when I was like 4. So for me, I'm like, yeah, that's a natural progression. Like, a little boy wants to learn how to shoot a gun, you teach him how to shoot a gun, there you go.
And Oswald Cobblepot is incapable of being a functioning adult, so he doesn't know any better not to just teach the boy how to shoot a gun the next day.
It's clearly going to lead somewhere, and I have ideas of where this plot will lead, but I'm waiting to see if that's the case.
What did you think about the big battle between Aquaman and Flashpoint Batman and Wonder Woman?
Look, I thought it was interesting. I found it entertaining. So for me, the whole battle and kind of learning where the two sides actually stood and what the reality was between Aquaman and Wonder Woman, I enjoyed that revelation. I also enjoyed the reveal that Aquaman wasn't behind the death of Barry Allen and that someone else is. So I'm curious to kind of see where that goes. And again, just this idea of time and this ticking of time that's passing by that keeps kind of alluding back to the same things that they were doing in Doomsday Clock. All of that together just kind of is, for me, making me more interested. I just want to focus back on our main Earth, not necessarily this Flashpoint world.
As you mentioned, the main Earth, there's not a whole lot there, but we do learn that the Flash himself is aiding Bruce Wayne Batman in whatever the investigation that he's actually doing. We don't learn a whole lot here other than they definitely hint at the button, which was leading into Doomsday Clock back in the day. So definitely more hints, as you were alluding to earlier, that perhaps this is a continuation or an expansion of really what he wanted to do in Doomsday Clock.
They directly call out the button in an editor's note, and they reference plot lines from that involving Thawne. Again, and I feel like a broken record saying this, but we know that Geoff Johns' Doomsday Clock didn't end up being what we wanted it to be or what he wanted it to be. It got changed. So it feels like this is a way of kind of giving us what was supposed to happen. Every page that I read, I feel like it leans more heavily into that notion. And because of that, I want more. Like, I just want more.
Definitely a step up in art. I would definitely recommend this one more than Batman 123. A lot of interesting stuff here. And if you like Flashpoint and you're interested in that universe, you're going to love this comic book. I just don't know why it's really important to read it, but it is entertaining. All right, let's go to the final comic book we're going to review today. Batman Killing Time number 3, Tom King, David Marquez. This thing started out with a bang. It was almost like a 5-star perfect comic book, you know, in the running for best comic of 2022, at least early on. And it feels like it's definitely lost some steam. This is a better issue than number 2. But the time jumping is definitely getting annoying.
Yeah.
He's trying to be Quentin Tarantino, but he's not Quentin Tarantino. No. In fact, he introduces the wolf, now called the Helper in his universe. Or I'm sorry, the Help.
Tom King needs to stop with this whole time jump thing. He's doing it in every comic. It's old. He doesn't do it well enough to make it as effective as he thinks he is. And it just comes across as he's trying too hard. And at this point, he's jumping back and forth like an hour and then 45 minutes and then 6 minutes ago and 7 minutes in the future. And it's just like, dude, you're making this more difficult than it needs to be. And you actually have an interesting plot here that if you would just let it flow, it would build momentum instead of pull people from the story. But you're insistent on, like, you know, tugging your own meat to make yourself feel better so you can do this and try to be cool. It's not cool, man. It's not cool.
It's never cool to tug your own meat, especially in a comic book. But I'm with you. It just comes off as pretentious writing tropes 101 from Tom King. And it does distract from what is a pretty interesting kind of heist story that's going on. We can keep up with it, but it's making it not fun to keep up with it.
100% agreed. And I agree that I don't think the help is as effective as the wolf, but I like the idea of the help. I like the idea of the help being someone that Oswald Cobblepot, of all people, would call on. I like the idea that he has trained with some of the same people that Batman has trained with, and that's why he's this, like, illustrious hitman who's like just at the age of retiring, so he doesn't do it as often. Like, I like all of those elements. I think those are great things, but you couldn't enjoy it because it's too busy trying to be so self, like, entertained and self amused. And Tom King's just like having a piss because he thinks he's incredible. And like, there's good writing here. There's a good story here, but you're getting in your own way.
Well, there's certainly a lot of good art. And I think the term you were searching for was self-indulgent.
Yes. There we go.
That nobody's more impressed with the writing in this comic book than Tom King himself, and I think that's one of the big issues.
Absolutely.
Now, the big mystery is what's in the box, and now we know that it has something to do with Ra's al Ghul, who acquired the box back in the 1800s and then gave it to Bruce, like the last day of his training before Bruce ended up leaving and kind of going on his own. It's supposed to be like a Christian artifact. How that's going to play out in the end, I'm not really sure, but he's giving us some answers here, and I just wish he would just cut out the crap and just tell the story as it is.
Yeah, I like the idea of this Christian artifact and the idea that it's tied to, like, Ra's al Ghul, and there's some history here, and it's kind of like Da Vinci Code-esque that's going on. Like, there's a mystery here. I'm curious to see where it goes. I'm also curious to see how this artifact departed from Bruce. So we've got an interesting story and a fun little mystery. Like, if we could just stick with a linear plot, it would definitely help this book.
My assumption, the way that it departed Bruce, was when it was stolen out of the vault, right? Because Batman said it wasn't Vault 6, was it? They're like, yes, it was.
You're right. I had actually forgotten about that. So I'm glad you said that. Yes, you are correct.
This would be a really great story if Tom King could just get over himself and try and go out there and just write a good comic story. But he wants to be so cute that it does take some satisfaction. So this isn't a bad week in Batman, Josh. There's a lot of good stuff to read. There's some things that aren't hitting quite as well as they were earlier. But, you know, if you read any one of these comic books, I don't think you're going to come away and be like, those assholes, you know, sold me a bill of goods on a bad comic. I don't think any of them are great, but they're all fine enough.
Yeah, they're good enough. I came in with expecting all three of these books to be worse than they were. So that definitely helped my reading experience. Other than that, I think we need to make, quote, cute Tom King a thing for future streams.
If you're here for the end of the video, I assume that you are a fan of Batman and DC Comics, and perhaps like the movie The Batman. It was recently greenlit for a sequel. I talked about that and some of the things that I thought really worked in the film itself. Definitely check this out if you're a fan of the Batman himself. You're excited for the sequel and you want to have a conversation about it.